we have a crash on the track.
Kyle Busch, who does not have a provisional to fall back on in this limited effort out of the Hendrick R&D shop, and now he's got a very wrinkled up race car.
And we just talked to him and asked him, was he going to go for it or, you know, just try to get a top 15 run? And he's a little bit upset.
Mm-hmm. That was coming to the green flag, wasn't it?
And the south. And the ambulance is chasing him.
They may not catch him for a while.
I know they won't.
Let's go back and show you what happened.
Well, it happened as he exited turn four, coming down four, the green flag. Boy, a little bit loose. He was on the gas, though,
wasn't he? Tried saving it, yeah.
He chased it, didn't catch it.
Yeah, he was on the gas. The green flag,
flag is still going.
Yeah, he's still waving that green flag.
Oh, if he'd have just kept it from rolling a Clark. Well, never mind. It was never a wrecked car anyway.
Just wow. Right when you jump on the throttle. Broke loose.
And then broke.
And then broke. Traction.
So. His qualifying has started.
Never a good sound. And so Kyle is back in the garage area. And we were talking with Casey Kane when things went wrong for Kyle. Marty, you want to continue?
I'm an eighth at Richmond. He's gotten steadily better in the Burger King Chevy.
First lap, 29.817. Good qualifying run. Puts him up in the eighth spot with another one to go.
Top 25 spots at stake. 44 cars are here. 25 will make the field today. And Nemechek spins it and turns green four and slams the outside wall. Hard lick by Joe Nemechek. The car just abruptly breaking loose and goes sideways, loops around, and Ned, he hit a ton.
Yes, he did. He hit that outside wall very hard. Derek Koch is coming around now. They're sending a car out after the car that's under the puck gets the black flag. They're sending the next car out. Of course, the caution lights are on. And they'll slow Derek Koch down, and he won't take the green flag, of course, until they get out and get Nemechek's car away. We'll take a look at what happened as he went into turn three. Nemechek had a pretty good lap on that first one, as you mentioned, 29.817, 183.761 miles an hour. So he goes into turn three, and looking pretty smooth right there. And then all of a sudden, the back end just gets loose. And around he goes, and there's not much he can do with it here, Jared, and it slams hard into the outside retaining wall, then comes all the way down across the racetrack and hits the inside retaining wall. Here we see him coming at the wall, and he hit the left side on the outside, and the right side took care of it when he came down and hit the inside retaining wall, but he's out of the car.
And his first lap time was 29.817 seconds, 183.761. That's eighth quickest, but... You see him out walking around. A little different angle now from that spin by Nemechek in turn four.
You see, just all of a sudden, he was in the gas.
Nemechek, who crashed on his second qualifying.
He went down across the racetrack into the inside retaining wall, doing more damage.
Now our pulse.
Well, next up here at Atlanta Motor Speedway, as we continue with live Georgia Pacific Bud Pole qualifying, is Ricky Rudd, and he's gonna spin, keep it away from the wall. Can't do it. Boy, he has had some real heartbreaks in the last few weeks, hasn't he?
And now it usually happens in the race, and it started on qualifying this time.
Boy.
Goes down the corner at about 205 miles per hour, and the back end flies out from under. And I thought for, about two or three seconds, he might keep it off the fence, but not so lucky. Here we go, down the corner, and right here, the car just bashed a little bit too loose. They're trying to get that speed, and Ricky just nails the gas, trying to keep it off the fence, but it would not spin around, make that 360 and lose momentum. Backed her in the fence. Another angle. And see, boy, he really smokes those rear tires, doesn't he, Bob?
Mm-hmm.
On that gas. Now he finally hits the brakes. And so the gas didn't work. Let's try the brakes.
right there as you see the car break away, and then he lays down some marks on the pavement and up into the wall hard.
You see that? Those things leaving black marks on the racetrack. As it, look at that left rear, just leaving a black mark as it goes through.
So the Texaco Haviland Ford is damaged severely. Ricky Rudd is out of the race car and is surveying the damage. That's the good news.
TNT Sports is live at the Pocono Raceway in Long Pond, Pennsylvania. 44 cars making the dash for the Bud Poll, getting ready for Sunday's running of the Pennsylvania 500. 16 cars have attempted the run so far. Bill Elliott is currently the fastest, and just moments ago, Kirk Shelmerdine lost the edge on his car and backed it into the wall. And you saw an example of what happens when something goes wrong here at Pocono, Wally.
Yeah, he got behind on the steering big time. It sounded like he was off the throttle for a long time and really jumped back in the throttle. And that is what you get.
Now, step back from the screen and listen.
Can leave a mark.
Yep, that's coming off of turn three under the long front stretch. And again, you're trying to get through that turn as quickly as possible because it sets up that run down the front stretch and the entire lap. So Kirk out of the car, obviously very disappointed. It's a nice hand from the fans here and a good crowd here, as always, for qualifying at Pocono. Terry Labonte played it cool again this weekend. Really, he had no choice. His primary car was a battered and singed tribute to his Ironman status. After just two laps of practice on Friday, Labonte had a wrecked race car, a broken finger, and a suddenly weak grip on an already frail lead in the points race.
Yeah, we've already seen some fireworks yesterday in practice. Now, this is a Brickyard. It's a very important race to these guys. They're going to push the envelope a little bit harder. The thing is, Brickyard is very tough to hit your marks. You have to be perfect. But like I said, this is a big event. We see a lot of guys. We see Pruitt got around, got the wall real hard yesterday with a stuck throttle on Herbie Sadler.
And Greg Biffle.
And then Biffle went in a little hard, too. So, you know, these guys are going to give it a little bit more here because, like I said, it's an important race. But it's so hard to qualify here because if you miss your marks just by a couple of feet, it really shows up on the watch.
And that was Greg Biffle. All three of those drivers will attempt to qualify backup cars here today.
Where for the ninth consecutive year, a near-record crowd has gathered to watch NASCAR's finest compete for 250 miles on this massive two-mile oval known as Michigan Speedway. On Friday, Mark Martin's final Busch Series visit to Michigan ended prematurely with this hard crash off of Turn 2 during qualifying. Martin's 44 victories makes him the winningest driver in Busch Series history, and he would have been looking for win number 3 at Michigan today.
Ken, I think complex certainly describes it. Probably a better choice of words would be treacherous. Already in the last day and a half, we've had 10 to 12 cars that has brushed the wall in some shape, form, or fashion. Yesterday in qualifying, here you see Buckshot Jones coming off turn two, qualifying, loops it. Ken, he was one of the lucky ones. He went on and completed his qualifying run, but he does have to run this qualifying race. He just wasn't quite quick enough to make the field. And you said it. Four cars make the 300, the other 13, their 1990 season comes to a close a little early.
And Derek Coates starts from the pole, but you're looking at what was left of his car from yesterday. As Larry McReynolds said, this is a treacherous racetrack. And Derek Coates, it doesn't take much to get out of shape here, and those weren't good pictures.
No, they weren't. Obviously, first thing on Friday morning, we got in trouble and wrecked the Badcock Jasper Ford, but pulled our backup car out. The guys did a great job getting it out just in time for us to get some laps, and still fighting it a little bit here and handling, but we'll get her together here and get a good run in hopefully today.
Well, we heard Greg Biffle say on the radio he was a little too conservative. How much do you feel like that conservatives cost you, Greg?
Well, it cost me at least a tenth and a half or so. You know, just was real gun shy about wrecking that Busch car. I got down in the corner there and see my black mark still in the wall in 3 and 4. And, you know, just wanted to get in the National Guard car, just a good lap. And I got into 3 and 4 there, and it kind of spooked me, and I run it up the hill, and then I got tight on my first lap, so I ran a 50, and I knew it was way better car than that, and, you know, 19 on the second lap. But the guys, I told them, they did a great job. It was a great car. Probably capable of being on the pole if I'd have drove it right.
Thanks, Greg.
That is Greg Biffle's NASCAR Busch Series qualifying effort from earlier. You
saw him bouncing off the safer barrier.
Happy to report here in Charlotte that A.J. Foyt, who ran into the wall a ton during practice on Tuesday for this race, was taken off in a stretcher and reported in serious condition for several days. A.J. is all right. He was released from the hospital earlier this week, flew home, and is resting comfortably in Houston, Texas. Best news of all is AJ says he'll be back. In one of the spookier circumstances of that event, AJ switched helmets just before he went back out. Johnny Hayes, I know, is willing to credit saving AJ's life with that change from an old style of helmet to a new one. That's it for now from the Goodyear Racing Update Center. Let's get back to the racetrack.
Talk about a pretty good one and two. Well, here's what one looked like yesterday.
Yeah, Mark, he came right down against the outside wall and made a real abrupt turn down to the bottom of the car and the rear end just did not hang on. You saw the springs fly out of it in the
regular incident. But this was the scariest moment during practice. Jarrett Johnson bursting into flames. Luckily, though, he's able to escape without injury. But for more on that particular incident, let's go to our Chevy cutaway car and Tim Brewer.
Is this the same Napa Camry that he brushed the wall with at the end of practice?
Yeah. I don't think they went to a backup car. I think he's going to be maybe in the 79. I don't think that's going to be safe.
I saw him running that high line in practice on a qualifying run, and I thought, well, then there's where he had.
Oh, no.
Oh, for Pete's sake, brother.
That is a hard lick. He was way too high there on lap two, Darrell.
I just don't.
Yeah, I'm fine.
I do not.
Boys. I just can't drive my car. So I really struggle with hanging on to him.
Poor guy. If you only. Gosh.
Watch how high he is here as he starts working off turn two, Darrell. The car's just sliding, losing grip.
And he's trying to stay after it. You know, he wants to try to get a better lap. He knows that one wasn't good enough to get in. And you've got to thank God the safer barrier was right there. But he's going to take another pretty good lick right here at the end. I'll tell you, boys, it's breaking my heart to watch this.
A hard crash for Michael Waltrip. He misses the wall on the outside as the car goes loose.
Same place he hit the wall in practice. Scraped it down there on his other practice qualifying run. He was up high like that. I thought maybe he was trying to something different.
I mean, you don't think he hit that wall hard. There was a coil spring came out of it bouncing across the racetrack.
There's parts flying everywhere.
Another tough day for Michael, who has made only the Daytona 500 this season. STG car. The 47 goes to Schrader, he's got to make it on time.
He just got to make it right now. He couldn't save it.
Just couldn't save it.
Should have just got out of it, tried to keep going.
And John Andretti gets to breathe a little easier for a while. Andretti's the man on the bubble. Schrader was trying to take the spot away.
Actually, who's the only one left? It'd be Menard, right?
And, no,
well, Kenny Wallace has still got to go.
And Almirola.
And that's a shame for Kenny. He just gets in a little high, and you see the car. He hits those bumps down in the middle of one and two, and it starts up the hill with him. I think Kenny's thinking, I don't want to lose all my momentum. See it bounce around right there, and I don't want to lose all my momentum. He thinks he's got it saved, but he gets the dirt all. He gets in the loose stuff. Now he's got the wheels turned right and it snaps back.
Yeah, you're up there where oil dry, tire rubber, everything else, no grip at all.
More than that, it's a brand new racetrack. And a brand new racetrack, the way the asphalt is between the aggregate and the binder. Look at all that smoke up there. That's not from the car or the tires. That's from the dust on new asphalt. Every time you run a car around there, it pulls a little more of that dust out, asphalt dust out. It collects at the top of the racetrack, and you're up there in no man's land.
I think Kenny will be, I guarantee he'll tell you, look, if I'd